In this portion of our class, and for the rest of the semester, we're going to look at two of the sacraments in particular. We're going to take some of that knowledge we have now about general sacramental theology, about the nature of the liturgy, and we're going to unpack it by looking at the sacraments of baptism and the Eucharist. And as we do this, first of all, know that we can't be exhaustive. So we're going to look for 2 weeks at baptism and 2 weeks at the Eucharist. And these are sacraments that you could easily have full courses on. So we're going to try to get some of the basics. And as we do it, there's various ways that you could approach studying these individual sacraments. So for instance, we could take an historical approach and say, let's start with precursors or foreshadowings in the Old Testament or even in pagan religions, and then move through the New Testament and the patristic era and the medieval era and so on and so forth, and look at the developments historically. Or we could take a systematic approach and look at those things that you would find in something like Roger Nutt. We could ask questions of the sacrament of baptism, like what is the form and matter, and who are who's the minister and the recipient, and what are the effects? And that stuff will come up here in the approach we're taking, but it's not the central focus. You could look at the sacrament of baptism through the lens of church teaching and look at what various popes and councils have said about sacraments. What we're going to do is what's called a mystagogical catechesis or a mystagogical theology. That is, we're going to look at the sacrament of baptism by looking at the sacrament of baptism, by looking at the ritual, the rite, how the church actually celebrates the sacrament of baptism. And it's from the rite that we're going to gain a knowledge of the meaning of the sacrament itself. So mystagogy means being led into the mystery. So our task over the next couple weeks is to be led into the mystery of baptism and then the Eucharist. You'll see here I don't have slides because the content here is so text-heavy. I want you to see scriptural passages. I want you to see quotes that PowerPoint slides really wouldn't work as well here. So feel free to either read along with me here on the screen if you're watching on the screen, or print notes off and read along yourself. So in these videos, we're going to look at what's called the praenotanda of the rite, or the introduction. Praenotanda is just the Latin for the preceding notes, praenotanda. And every sacramental book, every liturgical book, has before the ritual or the rite itself, it has these introductions. Some are longer, some are shorter, some are more detailed, some are less. But these introductions tend to lay out both the theology of the sacrament being celebrated and also some of the practical matters of how to celebrate it. We're going to be focused primarily on the theological elements, but also some of those practical elements as they... the practical elements have theological reasons. So we'll look at some of the practical matters, but from the lens of asking the question why, theologically, why is this particular rubric, this particular instruction present? Okay, so to give just a little bit of a rationale for this approach, this mystagogical approach, here's two quotes from the Catechism. The first is specifically about baptism. It's from Catechism of the Catholic Church 1234, so easy to remember. And the Catechism here says that the meaning and grace of the sacrament of baptism are clearly seen in the rites of its celebration. That's perhaps the main idea of mystagogy, or a mystagogical catechesis, right? That if I want to know the meaning and the grace or the effect of a sacrament, I can see it in how the rite is celebrated. So that means a proper celebration of the ritual is going to disclose the church's understanding of that sacrament. And so the Catechism goes on, by following the gestures and words of this celebration with attentive participation, The faithful are initiated into the riches this sacrament signifies and actually brings about in each newly baptized person, right? So if I want to be initiated into the meaning of what's going on in baptism, what do? I pay attention to the words, that is the prayers, and the gestures, the ritual actions. We'll see with baptism as we go forward in our class. A lot of times what's written in the book isn't always what's fully presented in the parish. And a lot of that has to do with some of the gestures and movements that are present. We're going to pay special attention to that kind of thing. Elsewhere in the Catechism, in paragraph 1124, it says that the Church's faith precedes the faith of the believer who is invited to adhere to it. When the Church celebrates the sacraments, she confesses the faith received from the apostles, right? When the Church celebrates the sacraments, she confesses the faith received from the apostles. And this isn't referring just to, well, during, say, the Mass, we profess the Creed. It's not just that. It's in the celebration of the sacraments in general. The Church is professing the faith, right? The celebration of sacraments is itself a confession of the faith received from the apostles. Whence, the Catechism goes on, whence the ancient saying, lex orandi, lex credendi. That's kind of the bumper sticker version, the shortened version, right? And it has a nice ring. Lex orandi, lex credendi, which is in Latin, in English, the law of praying is the law of believing. Or it gives the extended and original version, according to Prosper of Aquitaine, 5th century, legem credendi lex statuat supplicandi, which I have to think of the translation off the top of my head. It's a little more complicated. The law of supplicating, the law of petitioning, the law of praying, establishes the law of believing. So you can see why it's shortened to lex orandi, lex credendi. Prosper of Aquitaine, by the way, for trivia's sake, was a disciple or a follower of St. Augustine. So then the bold there, the law of prayer is the law of faith. The Church believes as she prays. Liturgy is a constitutive element of the holy and living tradition. That is to say, do you want to see what the Church believes? Listen and watch to how she prays. And if you listen and watch how the Church prays, you will know what she believes. So that's this general idea of lex orandi, lex credendi, of mystagogical catechesis. This is the foundation under which I think we were justified in saying, if we want to learn about the sacraments, let's look at the sacraments as they're celebrated in ritual motion. Okay, so I asked you to read two introductions. The first was this general introduction to Christian initiation. So this introduction appears at the beginning of the ritual book for the baptism of children, which we're looking at. It also is placed at the beginning of the RCIA, the Rite of Christian Initiation for Adults. This introduction ties together baptism, whether it be of an adult or of an infant. Okay, so you'll find this introduction in both books. The second introduction has more to do with specifically infant baptism. This introduction also ties together the three sacraments of initiation: baptism, confirmation, and Eucharist. So one of the reasons that this is theology right here, right? One of the reasons the Church puts this introduction at the beginning of baptism and the beginning of RCIA, why not just have an introduction just on baptism? It wants to show the unity of the three sacraments of initiation. So for instance, by the way, anything in purple is my additions, my notes. The things in black are the rite itself, the introduction itself from the book. So to give this idea of the unity of the sacraments of initiation, here's the Catechism quoting Pope Paul VI in his Apostolic Constitution on Confirmation. And Pope Paul VI says the sacraments of Christian initiation, baptism, confirmation, and the Eucharist lay the foundations of every Christian life. The sharing in the divine nature given to men through the grace of Christ bears a certain likeness to the origin, development, and nourishing of natural life. And now what he's doing here, he's actually drawing on Thomas Aquinas and drawing a parallel between supernatural life in the sacraments and natural life in birth, the origin of life, birth, growth and development, and then nourishing, right? So he says, the faithful are born anew by baptism. They're strengthened, that's the development, by the sacrament of confirmation, and nourished, receive the Eucharist, in the Eucharist, the food of eternal life. By means of these sacraments of Christian initiation, they thus receive in increasing measure the treasures of the divine life and advance towards the perfection of charity. So right away, as we begin this, note that baptism, the church wants us to place baptism in the context of a unity of the sacraments of initiation. So we want to think of baptism along with confirmation and the Eucharist. So much so that if we were to do a historical piece here, in the early church, these three sacraments were received all at once. And Eastern Catholics still receive, as infants, baptism, confirmation, and the Eucharist all at once, as infants, right? It's actually through an odd historical series of events that the sacraments become separated in time. I'll try not to go on too many tangents here to keep these videos short, so we'll leave it at that. Now, that being said, please note that the whole point of this, one of the points of this introduction here, this general introduction, is to display the unity of these sacraments, these three sacraments. I'm taking that completely out of context. I'm only highlighting baptism here for our purposes. So you'll notice as you read it, there were references to the reception of the Spirit and becoming partakers of the Paschal Mystery through the Eucharist. I'm just not covering those here because our time is short and we want to focus on baptism. So ritual number one in this general introduction to Christian initiation tells us what Christian initiation does, what happens through these sacraments. So it says, in the sacraments of Christian initiation, we are, and then it's going to list various effects of these sacraments in the Christian's life. Everything in purple again is my additions. What I wanted to show here, and it's worth going through this, I think, is the depth of scripture that these notes pull from. These praenotanda, these introductions, are imbued with scripture, and sometimes it's explicitly footnoted, and you can see that if you're looking at the rite itself, a copy of it. Sometimes they're just allusions that are not footnoted. I tried to draw out both some of the important footnotes and some other references that I think are being alluded to here to scripture. So a lot of this introduction, or a lot of my notes here on this introduction are, let's make explicit some of the scriptural background to understanding the sacraments. Saint Jerome once said that ignorance of scripture is ignorance of Christ. I think one could also say ignorance of scripture is ignorance of the liturgy, because the liturgy is just imbued with the language and mentality and culture of scripture. So in the sacraments of Christian initiation, we are first, A, freed from the power of darkness. And light and darkness are some of the primary images used in baptism. It's so much so that in the early church, one of the names of baptism was enlightenment. And we still have these images of, think of the Easter vigil of darkness, of lighting candles. Even at the baptism of an infant, a candle is received and we say, receive the light of Christ. And this is again scriptural imagery. So from Colossians here, Colossians 1:11-14 is, we're going to mention it here, but you'll notice through the videos it comes up often. This is a key text in the imagery for baptism, where Paul says, may you be strengthened with all power according to his glorious might for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Now, one can already see why this would be a text, maybe if it's not referring directly to baptism, this is a text that the baptismal liturgy would take on, right? What happens at baptism? The Father qualifies us, making us his sons and daughters to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. And then it says, he has delivered us from the dominion of darkness, right? The dominion, the rule. We were under the rule of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. So this is interesting. When you read in the introduction to the sacrament, that Christian initiation freed us from the power of darkness. Again, this is where ignorance of scripture is ignorance of the liturgy. All of this passage stands behind that allusion to power of darkness, right? What has God done for us? He's given us inheritance with the other saints in light. He's transferred us from being under the dominion or rule of darkness into the kingdom of his beloved Son, and he's forgiven our sins. We also see this this imagery elsewhere. So for instance, in Ephesians, right in the middle there, number two, Ephesians 6:12, Paul says, "For we are not contending against flesh and blood, but against the principalities, against the powers, against the rulers of this present darkness, against the spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places." Right? So Paul is saying in our struggle in the Christian life, it's not against the rulers of this world, but it's against this darkness, right? The darkness, the dominion of darkness that baptism transfers us from. And this imagery of light goes to the very nature of God, says John in 1 John 1:5, Roman numeral 3 here. "This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all." So here's the first effect of baptism, is we are freed from the power of darkness. And then the second thing is, there's B, sorry about the jumping around here, I've got to get used to this. Through Christian initiation, we're joined to Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And this is one of the key passages from, let's get the exact verses. It's Romans 6, we're going to look at the end first. Romans 6, 3 through 11. Romans 6, right in the middle of Paul's letter, this is the epistle that's read on the Easter Vigil. As people are preparing to be baptized at the Easter Vigil, this is one of the final readings, right before the gospel that's proclaimed. And Paul asks this kind of rhetorical question. And he's going to have this strong idea, this mystical idea of participating in what Christ did. So we're joined to the Paschal mystery. And Paul says, "Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death?" Now, we read that in English and we think of baptized, having water sprinkled on you. What does it mean to be baptized into his death, right? The Greek here, baptized, baptizo, means to be plunged or dunked, right? When I teach fifth graders, right, I always say, if you were living in Greece, you would go to baptizing donuts instead of Dunkin' Donuts, right? You would baptize your Oreo in milk. You dunk it. So it's the idea of being plunged, immersed. So you read this sentence in Paul in that Greek sense of that, then it makes a little more sense. Do you not know that all of us who have been plunged into Christ Jesus were plunged into his death, right? So there, it has a very visceral, it has a dynamic sense to it. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. This is the imagery of full immersion baptism in particular, where a person goes under the water, right, as if buried, and then comes out as if rising. in the early church, there are intimations that the person may not quite have known what was going to happen. And so the bishop would ask, do you believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth? And the person would say, I do. And then they'd be gurgling. You know, they wouldn't know what was going on. And so this idea of being buried would be very clear. I've seen up where I'm from, a country parish where the pastor used to do full immersion infant baptism. So there'd be naked baby, and the priest would say, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and would dunk the child. All of it, right? And there would be, if people hadn't been there or weren't used to it, there would be audible gasps. Because you get it, baby isn't supposed to go underwater, because that's bad, right? Baby doesn't care, of course. Baby's fine, maybe cry a little. But this idea of plunging into death and coming out is very strong in that kind of full immersion baptism. So this is the imagery Paul's thinking of you're being plunged into Christ's death. But it's even stronger than that. You'll, if we had time, we'd read St. Cyril of Jerusalem talks about the reality of this, that yes, it's done in a figure under sacramental signs, but it's this sacramental principle that we've looked at all semester. We participate in this mystical way in what Christ did. So Paul goes on after the bold there. We know that our old self was crucified with him so that the sinful body might be destroyed. This all happens in baptism for Paul, right? And we might no longer be enslaved to sin, for he who has died is freed from sin. If you died in baptism, you're free from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. For we know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. There's that word dominion again, right? The dominion of darkness, the dominion of death. It's been overcome. It's been conquered. The death he died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. So you, this is that mystical element, the body of Christ, what Christ did we do. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. This is all in the background to that idea of being conformed to participate in Christ's suffering, death, and resurrection through baptism. We get the same idea from Paul in Colossians 2. In him also you were circumcised with a circumcision made without hands, by putting off the body of flesh in the circumcision of Christ. And you were buried with him in baptism. You were buried with Christ in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. So the same idea as in Romans. You participated through baptism in what happened to Christ in the tomb. You were buried and raised. And you who were dead in trespasses, right? Dead in trespasses, as Christ was dead in the tomb, and the uncircumcision of your flesh, being outside of God's covenant, God made alive together with him, having forgiven all our trespasses, having canceled the bond which stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. The bond, by the way, side note, because I can't help myself, this bond which stood against us, in the Greek, it's one of like four Greek words I know, is a chirographon. Chiro has to do with hand, and graphon has to do with writing. So the bond which stood against us is... it's literally a handwritten note. So in the ancient world, a chirographon, or chirographon, I actually don't know how to pronounce the Greek. You probably wouldn't have known that had I not said that. But the chirographon was a handwritten receipt. So if I became indebted to someone, I would write them a handwritten receipt. And the idea here is, well, people debate who we're indebted to, but because of sin, we find ourselves in this debt. Seems to God, right? We're in this debt due to our sin. And so we've written this handwritten receipt. And what does God do with it? He nails it to the cross, canceling its legal demands on us. It's a beautiful image of what happens to our sins at baptism, right? The debt that stood against us is canceled, being nailed to the cross. Here is 1 Peter. This is another one of the verses or the passages that is cited by this passage in the Praenotanda. What happens at baptism? It says, for Christ also died for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which, that is the spirit, in which he went and preached to the spirits in prison who formerly did not obey. This is talking about Holy Saturday. What happened to the soul of Christ on Holy Saturday as his body rested in the tomb? He went to the spirits in prison and preached, those spirits who formerly did not obey, when God's patience waited in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is eight persons, were saved through water. Now here's, this is a very, there's some complicated stuff here. Here's our point. Peter is making a connection between the ark, Noah's ark, and baptism. He says, look, the righteous Noah and his family, these eight persons, were saved by passing through water. He says then baptism, which corresponds to this, right? Baptism, which was, you could say, foreshadowed by Noah's ark, now saves you. Here's the idea of baptism is actually effecting salvation, right? We call this regenerative baptism. Something happens. Baptism, which corresponds to this, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a clear conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God with angels, authorities, and powers subject to him. So let's see. Now I've got to remember what we said. So we're freed from the power of darkness, A. B, we're joined to Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And now what else does, well, sorry, here's another passage about that. Again, this is cited in the rite. It's actually one of the footnotes. We can just read the last sentence there in bold. He who believes and is baptized will be saved, but he who does not believe will be condemned. This is, again, just like Peter up there, the previous one. This is a note that baptism is regenerative. It actually participates as an action of salvation for those who believe. You know what? We'll leave it off here for this video so we don't get too long all at once. You can take a breather. So that was just number one. We'll have to speed up a little bit here. That was just number one in this first introduction on what does Christian initiation do? Freeing us from the power of darkness and conforming us to Christ by participating in his paschal mystery. Next, we'll look at specifically number two there. What does baptism do on top of that?